goodness with care from our villages Arokya milk.
Welcome to episode 14 of Mahabharata with Anuja. In the previous episode, we left things at Abhimanyu and Uttara's wedding. It was a very nice affair and a very happy reunion, but it was going to be a very brief period of happiness because after that, the Pandavas and all their allies, they gathered at Upaplavya and they decided on a course of action. They wanted to talk about how best to go about it. Now, Krishna was the first to talk. He said, let's try and find a peaceable solution, but I don't think Duryodhana will return the kingdom, so we'll have to start preparing for war. And Balarama also weighed in. He said, I don't think it's right that you demand your half of the kingdom, as you call it. The terms were that you guys go into exile for 14 years and after that you'll get your freedom back. The thing is, you gambled away the kingdom, so there's no guarantee that anybody should give it back to you. You have to approach Duryodhana as a supplicant and ask them to give you guys a livelihood. Now, Balarama's viewpoint mirrors what a lot of us are thinking, because Yudhishthira did gamble away his kingdom. Of course, he talked about, you know, how it was not honorable to you know, reject an extended challenge and stuff like that. But whichever way you look at it, he did make the choice to gamble away his kingdom. That's foolish. A lot of us think so. And Balarama just says that. But immediately Satyaki leaps forward and he says, why are you supporting the Kauravas? They cheated and won the kingdom and they forced Yudhishthira into a corner. How can he ignore Dhritarashtra's direct command? And they kept arguing back and forth like this, and finally Drupada, who was their father-in-law, he said, I'll tell you what, let me send my priest, let him go as a messenger and let's find out, you know, how things stand. And it was all agreed, and this priest made his way to Hastinapura, and Duryodhana's reply was, it was a very famous reply which he gave. He said, go back and tell those beggars that I will not part with even a needle point of land, he said. And the elders of course tried to tell him not to be so harsh, but he wouldn't listen. And Dhritarashtra said, tell Yudhishthira that we'll talk about it and get back to him. And he then sent Sanjaya as a messenger. Sanjaya came there and he counseled Yudhishthira. He said, see, even if they refuse to return Indraprastha to you, I know it's unfair, but don't go to war with your cousins because of this. What are you going to win? You kill all of them and you win a kingdom, what's going to happen? So you won't be happy either. So why don't you live in peace? Even if he refuses, maybe you guys can, you know, go to some other land and, you know, build yourself another kingdom. And even Yudhishthira, who was normally so patient, he was very, very irritated with this. He said, Sanjaya speaks with Dhritarashtra's voice. They are very close, so this is what my uncle feels. Even if his sons cheat me, I'm supposed to be quiet. So they told Sanjaya, sorry, it's not happening, very politely, and they sent him away. And Krishna said, we'll continue trying to look for a diplomatic solution, but prepare for war. And he left. Now both sides, they started jostling for power and position, and you know, they were trying to get strong allies. And Duryodhana and Arjuna made haste to follow Krishna to the Yadava capital of Dwaraka. And once there, they reached at exactly the same time. Duryodhana pretended Arjuna wasn't there. Arjuna ignored him. Duryodhana went and sat on the bed, and Arjuna stood at the foot of the bed. So when Krishna woke up, he saw Arjuna first, and Duryodhana said, hello, I was here first. You're related to both of us, so you have to be fair. And Krishna said, yes, yes, that's true. But I saw Arjuna first and he's younger, so it's customary to give him first choice. I will tell you what I'll do. I'll give both of you two choices. One, on the one hand, you have me. I will not pick up any weapons. I will not fight in this war. I offer only myself. On the other hand, I offer the mighty Yadava army. and Duryodhana was very angry that Arjuna gets to choose first. Now Arjuna didn't even hesitate. He said, "I choose you, Krishna." And Duryodhana was thinking, "Yes, this fellow may be a great warrior, but he has the brains of a donkey." And he said, "I choose your army." And very happily he left. And he met Balarama. Balarama told him, "I will not pick up arms against Krishna, so I will not be a part of this accursed war. I am going to go on a pilgrimage. Duryodhana, you are my student. Conduct yourself with honor and dignity." And you know, Duryodhana just listened with half a ear and he took off. And Krishna immediately asked Arjuna, "Are you sure you made the right choice?" Arjuna said, "With you by my side, I can never lose." And he was very happy and he went away. He did not notice that Krishna's smile was very sad, because he knew that Arjuna was going to, you know, lose a lot in this war. Now both sides were still gathering allies, lots of preparations were going on. And now the twins had a very powerful uncle. Their mother Madri's brother was King Shalya, and he was very powerful and he had a massive army. Now this king, he decided to join his nephews and he was marching to offer his help to the Pandavas. And Duryodhana had an eye on his army, and he immediately made some plans. He said, "At every point of his journey, I want him to be lavished with hospitality. Make sure that his every need is taken care of. And his men proceeded to do just that. And Shalya accepted all this lavish hospitality, thinking it was Yudhishthira's work. Now Yudhishthira had returned from exile. He didn't exactly have money, so Shalya should have been smart. But he was like, he called the men and he said, "I would like to thank my host for all this benevolence." And Duryodhana immediately stepped forward and Shalya said, "Oh, it's you. Tell me what I can do for you in return." And Duryodhana said, "Fight on my side." And Shalya had no choice but to accept. He said, I will just go and personally convey the news to Yudhishthira. He should hear it from me." So when he went there, the twins were so happy to see his mighty army. But he told them the bad news. And then Yudhishthira was thinking, "Oh, so Duryodhana is playing dirty. Let me see what I can do." And he told King Shalya, "At some point, you will be asked to be Karna's charioteer. At that point, you must do everything to, you know, drain Karna's morale. You should insult him, sap his energy. You know, just do this much for me." And King Shalya agreed. He blessed his nephews and he went on his way. Now they all stood poised on the brink of war, and at that point Krishna said, "Okay, I will make one last attempt for peace, and I have other business in Hastinapura, so let me go there." And Krishna made haste to go to Hastinapura. And at that point, Draupadi came to him and she said, "What, Krishna, why are you going for this peace talks and all?" Krishna said, "I don't want anybody to say that we didn't do everything in our power to find a peaceable solution." And even Bhima chimed in at that time. He said, "Yes, let's hope for peace." And Draupadi immediately said, "I was humiliated in front of all those men. Don't forget what happened to me. If you all won't fight on my behalf, my sons will fight. Abhimanyu will lead my sons. He will not allow my honor to be, you know, insulted like this. Abhimanyu will fight." She said like this, and Krishna said, "Calm down. Duryodhana is not going to accept. I'm just doing my best." And Krishna left for Hastinapura, and they say that there were horrible omens everywhere. You know, there was thunder and lightning, though there were no clouds, and the water in wells turned to blood, and lots of yucky things like this started happening. But on Krishna's route to Hastinapura alone, Bhumi Devi just blossomed, you know, because he was her favorite champion, and Krishna was surrounded by beauty, by nature's beauty, as he made his way to Hastinapura. And once there, he told them, "Listen, do the sensible thing. Why should brother fight brother? Yudhishthira is willing to settle for 5 villages. Give that much. And they'll be happy with it. Surely you can part with 5 villages, one for each brother." And Duryodhana said, "Listen, they are begging because they are scared that they lose what little they have, which is their lives. I will not budge." And immediately Bhishma said, "Duryodhana, listen to Krishna." And he said, Karna is the reason for all your stupidity." And he said, "You are thinking that with Karna on your side, you can win. But tell me, when the Gandharvas captured you in the forest, did Karna come to your help? He ran away. You were captured. And what about the battle, the recent battle in Virata's kingdom? Arjuna again defeated all of us put together, and he did it single-handed without any allies. Don't kid yourself into thinking that you can win." And Drona immediately seconded this. He said, Bhishma is right. The grandsire is always right. Karna is a fool and he's evil. He hates the Pandavas for some stupid reason of his own. Don't listen to Karna. And they even called Gandhari and she counseled her son. She said, please, let's settle for peace. Let's not go to war. But Duryodhana, he just turned around and walked out from there. He wouldn't listen to any of them. He got together with Karna, Shakuni and Dushasana. He said, Krishna is here alone. Let's capture him. The Pandavas won't go to war without him. And they say that Krishna knew of this, of course. And they say he took his Vishwarupa. And even Dhritarashtra, for that brief moment of glory, he could see. And having seen Krishna's divine splendor like this, he said, I don't want to see anything more. I'll be happy to be blind again. I don't want to see the bloodshed that follows. So Krishna granted his wish and Sanjaya was given divine vision so that he could report what happened in Kurukshetra to Dhritarashtra. And meanwhile, seeing that Duryodhana wasn't budging, Krishna immediately left. Duryodhana, he refused to eat at any of their houses, though they all offered. He went straight to Vidura's palace where Kunti was there and he consoled his aunt. Kunti said, see, I've had a hard life, widowhood, and then I had to depend on the charity of others. I saw my sons lose their kingdom. I saw them, you know, I know that they suffered during that period of exile. But the thing that hurts me the most is what they did to Draupadi. My blameless daughter-in-law, the evil which they did to her, for that alone, Krishna, you go back and you tell my sons to fight. No more talk of peace and all. Let them fight and take what is theirs. And Krishna immediately consoled her. He said, don't worry, your sons are going to win back everything they lost. Everything will be okay. And having consoled her, he next went and met Karna. He took him for a very, he took him on his chariot and both of them went and talked in secret. And Dhritarashtra heard about this and he asked Sanjaya, tell me about it. And then it so happened, Sanjaya told him, Krishna had revealed the truth about Karna's birth to him. And he said, the Pandavas are your brothers. You only made the first move. You chose Arjuna as your enemy. Forget all that. Go back, join your brothers. You're the eldest, so the kingdom belongs to you. And Karna immediately said, no. I know why you're telling me this secret now. You want me to leave Duryodhana, but I cannot betray my friend. I'm all he has. I will not join the Pandavas. Okay? And Krishna told him, see, you're actually a good person. You have a good heart. You're kind and generous. By joining these fellows, you're becoming every bit as villainous as them. What you did to Draupadi was wrong. You were angry because she insulted you at that Swayamvara, but the reason for that was me. She's my close friend. She never does anything without my permission. So when you picked up that bow, she looked at me and I shook my head because she was not meant for you, which is why she refused to marry you. Keeping that in mind, you suggested that she be disrobed. How do you justify such conduct? And Karna immediately lowered his eyes in shame. He said, you're right. You're right about everything, Krishna. I know I'm going to die, Krishna. It's okay. I'm not afraid of death. Life hasn't been good to me. But I will die with honor, Krishna. And the honorable path for me is to be loyal to Duryodhana. He's been more than a friend to me. I cannot betray him. And then he told Krishna something which proves what a noble soul Karna is. He told Krishna, promise me that you will not tell Yudhishthira and the other Pandavas that I am their brother. Yudhishthira will immediately offer the kingdom to me and I will offer it to Duryodhana. So please don't do this. And Krishna immediately blessed him. He said, don't worry, you're a worthy hero and people will always remember you and your deeds, Karna. And Karna was very happy to hear this and they parted ways after that. And so as I said, both sides were getting ready for Kurukshetra and there was a lot of plotting going on. And now Arjuna had many, you know, powerful allies and one of them was Indra, his heavenly father. And he wanted to give a massive advantage to Arjuna and so he made certain plans. And then Surya approached Karna. Surya is Karna's divine father, as you know. He approached him in his dream and he warned him. He said, Indra is going to approach you. He'll ask for the celestial armor and earrings. Don't give it up. Please don't give it up. If you do, you'll die for sure. Don't give it up. And Karna, even in his dream, he'll say, no. If somebody asks me for something, I will give them. Now, this is supposed to be noble, but I think it's stupid. When people ask you for dumb things, you shouldn't give it. But Karna said, no, I will not turn down anybody who asks me for something. And Surya said, okay, if you're going to be noble, at least be smart, ask for something in return. So Karna took his advice, and he was very much prepared when Indra came to him in disguise. And Karna smiled at him. He said, tell me, what can I do for you? Do you want wealth? Would you like me to capture Indra's kingdom for you? And he teased like that. So Indra, you know, revealed himself. He said, you know why I'm here? I would like the celestial armor and earrings. I see that Surya has paid you a visit. And Karna immediately said, you're welcome to it. I won't even hesitate. And he took a dagger and he sliced the armor off him. And he was bleeding and covered with bruises. And he tore the earrings because he was born with these things, right? And even Indra was deeply impressed. He blessed Karna and all his wounds disappeared. And he was perfect and unmarked and handsome as ever. And then Indra said, ask me for a boon in return. And Karna immediately pounced. He said, give me your Shakti, your infallible Shakti, your mightiest weapon. And Indra felt sorry for him because Karna looked so happy. So he said, okay, I'm going to give you a fair warning. Okay, the Shakti can be used only once and it will return to me. And I know who you want to use it against, but remember, that person is my blood. My weapon will not hurt one of my own, and he's also under the power and protection of, you know, the noblest soul in the world, the divine protector. Be very careful, Karna. And with that warning, he left. But Karna thought, no, what if he says all these things? I can use it once, I will use it on Arjuna. And he comforted himself like that. But there was a little more in store for him, little more emotional trauma, because the next person to pay him a visit was Kunti. Now Kunti had been thinking about it. She thought of all the mighty warriors on the Kaurava camp. Bhishma won't harm a hair on the heads of my children. He loves them even more than I do. Drona also loves my children. He won't kill them. That leaves Karna. Karna alone, he hates my son. Somehow I have to protect them. So thinking like this, Kunti went to the son she'd abandoned and whom, because of her action, his life had been so difficult. But anyway, she went up to him and very hesitantly she stood waiting for him to pay attention to her. And very kindly Karna approached her and he said, I'm Karna, the son of Radha. Tell me what I can do for you. And she winced because that was a barb. And she said, see, I'm very, very sorry for what I did to you. I can't, I can't begin to apologize, but I'm very, very sorry. I had no choice. And Karna, he didn't want to hurt her. So he said, all is forgiven. What's happened has happened. And then she said, join your brothers. Karna said, you know, I cannot do that. Then she said, I just join them, then I'll feel better, otherwise, you know. And she hesitated to say it, and then she said, spare my sons. I know I have no right to ask you anything, but spare the lives of my sons. And Karna smiled again. He glanced at the son. He was thinking to himself, I'm also her son, but she doesn't care. And then he smiled. He said, see, I'll tell you this much. Yudhishthira, Bhima, Nakula and Sahadeva, they are not as strong as me. I can easily kill them, but for your sake, I will not. Arjuna alone, I cannot make that promise. I will try to kill him. Either Arjuna or I will perish. But at the end of the day, you'll still have 5 sons. I hope you're happy with it. And with that, Karna will take his leave of Kunti. And all is set for the battle of Kurukshetra. And that concludes our 14th episode of the Mahabharata. I look forward to meeting you for the next one. I'm sure you have lots of things you want to say about the peace talks and about the fate of Karna. Be sure to share it with me. And don't forget to hit like, share and subscribe to this channel. I will see you soon. Stay tuned for the next episode. Until then, take care.
With care from our villages, Arokya Milk.